Ed Roland, Dean Roland, Johnny Rabb, Will Turpin, Jesse Triplett. Got them all.
Adam.
Welcome to the Press Shop, man. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
What a cool spot.
We have had a hell of a day today, man. I've had a blast. I want to start by talking to Dean. So, Dean, I've known Ed for a little bit now and really enjoy getting to know him. We met actually here for the first time. And It's been a real intriguing relationship, to say the least. We've already been to Palm Springs together. We've bought a car together. We've done all kinds of stuff. Our wives are a little suspect right now. But at any rate, you know, this is really cool to see you guys hanging out. It's the first time I've really seen you hang out. I saw you guys at a show together. But it's pretty special being brothers in a band together, I would think. You guys get along?
We get along very well.
Yeah.
We haven't always, or we don't always agree, but yeah.
You get along great, and sometimes you disagree great too, don't you?
Yeah.
I think that's the thing we've learned the best, disagree. Can we disagree?
Yeah.
Back in the day, it would elevate maybe. Now we're like, okay, that's his gig, that's my gig, and we'll go.
Only minimal bloodshed.
I don't think there was ever real blood drawn.
No. Never real blood? It's the name of this record. I don't know how that's where it came from. You're 10 years younger than Ed, right?
Yeah.
He told me that he didn't realize that you played guitar for quite a while. You've been playing it, I guess. And how did he realize that you played guitar? How did he discover that?
I'm not quite sure how he discovered it, because by nature, I'm introverted, I'm quiet. And I was just learning how to play. Will's brother was the one that was helping me learn, and Ed. I was just watch and learn. And then he was going through different configurations and
sexually.
Yeah. Transformations and
yeah.
Gather up a crucifix. Something's
Ask him.
No, I remember because I was at mom and dad. I came home with mom and dad's one night and you were in there playing. I had no clue. And that's.
Yeah,
so what you're in the living room or whatever room you call it back in the day. Because it was kitchen, living room, and the dining room or den.
Yeah.
They're all kind of about 10 by 10.
So you guys had a musical family, right? Your dad was was it director of music for, what was it called?
Yeah,
Minister of Music. So was that, were you looking up to your big brother playing guitar, or was it something that you got from
absolutely.
Your family?
Absolutely, yeah. Ed kind of set, our dad set the tone for the musical spirit in the family. For me, Ed set the tone for the musical inspiration of like what I would listen to. And it kind of went through our middle brother, John, as well. Because I'm the third brother, and I would.
It's funny you mentioned that. I don't even know what John's musical taste was.
That was awesome.
You and I, was it?
No.
You and I thought had this, you know, because I know we're different in age now that, but I wouldn't know what John listened to.
Oh, it was cool.
Remember?
Yeah, he had. Well, what, like, got my goat was he had Injustice for All. He had bought
Very
that.
Magic,
I'm like,
man.
Oh.
Mm, interesting.
So I got a little bit of. So Ed was coming from this early '80s. Like new wave vibe, melodic stuff, and then I was our middle brother John was he had this Metallica record. I mean, he was all over the place as well, but that one kind of stuck out to me and like spiked my brain a little bit.
I remember him going to Duran Duran concert. You remember, you may not remember this. For some reason I was at the house that night too, and he found a letter that this girl wrote, put on the stage. Wanting Simon, gave her number out and everything. Simon, give me a call. Little teenage girl.
Oh.
So John, I forgot who other. It might have been Scott. It might have been Shane's brother, Scott Evans.
Scott.
And they came in and they put a cassette on back in the day. You know, called this girl and brother John started having a British accent, pretending he was Simon Le Bon. You ever heard this story?
No.
This girl was going nuts. The funny thing is, about 10 minutes later. You know, brother John going, hello, this is Simon Le Bon. But then he's like, yeah, I really like you, you know, if you want to get together.
He lost it pretty quick.
He lost the character.
That was his Crank Yankers.
Yeah. Jerky Boys.
Yeah. So, like, in saying that, like, it was just a lot of musical influences, like, floating around. And I knew music, I played music, but I didn't think of myself as being a musician necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Ed was a musician, or our dad was. And then we played a couple of little acoustic things together. Will was there, and I don't know. I just kind of like latched on and we're like, let's, I don't know, we'll keep going.
I think it's so cool that you guys are brothers and you get along and you get to work together. I know he loves it. I mean, he talks about it, mm-hmm. you know, quite often to me. Just, it must be an honor to be out there with your brother. And also, I mean, you're 10 years younger than Ed, so yeah. I know he was a late bloomer in the music industry, so to speak, right? 30 years old when he got signed.
I tell him,
you were 20.
Yeah, I was his good luck charm. I was only playing together for like a year and a half or so.
Wow.
And then he was still doing the same thing. I'm just like, let's do it.
And were you partly responsible, I heard, for or maybe you were responsible for dropping off the demo?
That's what I did. Yeah.
That,
yeah.
So that's how it kind of started, the messenger. Right?
He was the messenger.
Somebody's got to do it.
Why drink the water from my hand, contagious as you think of? Why follow me to higher ground, lost as you swear I am? Just at me, I don't speak about, don't speak about. Turn your head now, baby, just at me out. Follow me to higher ground, lost as you swear I am. And don't throw away your basic needs, ambience and vanity. Turn your head now, baby, just stick me out. Don't worry about, don't speak about. Turn your head now, baby, just stick me out. Don't scream about, don't think about. Turn your head now, baby, just stick me out. Don't worry about, don't speak about. Turn your head now, baby, just stick me out. We'll be right back.
that. There's a picture the first time Atlantic, I saw it in your closet the other day, the first time Atlantic Records saw us, and I was like, and I could tell it was in a stack of 1990, late 93, 94 stuff. And I was like, wait, I didn't remember Atlantic Records seeing us. I'm like, playing congas. I didn't remember the first time they saw us, we had six on stage.
Yeah.
And I was playing congas and singing, playing percussion, singing backups.
When did you start playing bass?
I remember having a light bulb moment right, it was right before Toys for Tots, even though I didn't play bass on that. I called Ed. To me, the conversation went like this. I think I can play bass. And Ed's like, you sure you can play bass? I was like, I think I can play bass. And I'll do it. And
are you then, sure you can play bass?
Yeah, are you and sure you can play bass? I think I can play bass. We were deciding. Years later, we didn't know.
Yeah. And you guys have known each other your whole lives, right?
Yeah, well, it goes back to the church, too. Like, my earliest memories, I knew who they were. And their father, I remember being in the youth choir, and their father was my choir director when I was, gosh, I must have been earliest memories, 10, 11 years old, 9.
Same neighborhood?
Basically.
Just a street over.
Yep.
Street or two.
It's definitely the same neighborhood.
His dad was my employer, too, the studio.
Yeah, so you, reel-to-reel studio, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you still have that?
Yes, yeah.
Been around for a minute.
76.
It's awesome.
It's the oldest one in Georgia right now on the books. Yeah, in Georgia. Yeah.
Oldest recording studio in the state of Georgia.
So you you there a lot?
Yeah, I was there a lot. Yeah, before we started doing.
He didn't do shit.
Oh, when I was growing up,
he didn't do shit.
No, you know what I did do was I got to hear so many different types of music. It didn't matter if it was bluegrass or Ed stuff, and we really looked up to Ed. We watched him work on his craft in my father's studio, but Ed's new wave, rock and roll, and bluegrass, and country, and I got to hear all kinds of different music.
She said the time is unfair to a woman her age. Now that wisdom has come, everything else fades. Says she realizes she's seen a better days. She said she can't look back to her days of youth. What she thought were lies, she later found was true. Said her daddy had dreams, but he drank them away. And a mother's to blame for the way she is today. Like Trevor shall rise, she said, or be the strong shall spike, she said. For salvation's light, yes, she wishes all day, and then she prays all night. Said she won't speak of love, this love she's never known. Still, it's moments like these she hates to be alone. We'll be right back.
Johnny. So
Johnny son.
Yeah, Johnny, so Rab, Johnny son.
Johnny Rab, you're a drumming legend. You know, if you've been around for a while, it was Jesse. I'm saying, man, I can't believe I'm in a band with this guy. You know, he said he used to look up to you so much, have drumsticks, signature drumsticks.
Yep. I used to buy the DW Drum Day 90, I whatever.
I think that's
it was.
So cool.
And I would
man.
Go buy, I'd go to Drums 101 in Athens and buy your drumsticks.
Dude, that's awesome. Well, the way I feel about these guys is the exact same way. I mean, I did the drumming industry thing for a long time, grew up in California, moved to Nashville, and that kind of was the connection. I'm very happy with the 12 years I spent in Nashville because I forced myself into the drum community almost backwards. I was trying to do gigs, like tour with country artists, whoever would have me do it. And I had the stick company. And through that, it's kind of how we met because I was demoing for Roland Electronics as like their head, you know, V-drum specialist and all this stuff. And really thankful that we met at a NAMM show through a friend of ours. And because this is what I've been wanting to do. This is what I did in California. That's what I did in school. And I kind of got away from that and got kind of pigeonholed as a clinician guy. And I still
a what?
Clinician.
Yeah. Like a, you know, like a drum clinic.
I've heard that term.
Clinician. Yeah.
Doctor. I'm a medical doctor.
He likes fishing.
That's a good word, though. I'll use it.
Clinician.
I'm the
I used to go to the drum clinics all the time, dude.
Yeah.
I love it.
And kind of there it is. I mean, it literally went from doing those demonstrations and, you know, here's how this whole, you know, piece of gear works, whether it's a drum, cymbal, or obviously cymbals and drums you hit, but the electronic ones were like, I would program some of the models of those things. That would be my job, like to make the actual internal drum sets. Pretty nerdy. And then thankfully I met these dudes and we're there.
You tell it good, but that morning we went and saw him.
Did you say I tell it good?
You tell that story good. But talking about nerdy.
Oh yeah.
Well, it was NAMM that morning. I'll go ahead and see how far I can get. But it was NAMM that morning. I was like, Ed, I met this guy, Johnny Rab, last night. He's doing a clinic as a clinician.
Yeah, there you go.
And we went and watched him, and he had dialed up something with Run, I think.
Yeah.
I was like, man, I'm really happy. And Ed, and what was your comment? He's overqualified.
You said, yeah, I think in the Will Turpin voice. Yeah, he can come audition. And I was like, he's overqualified.
No, I did not say he can audition. I was
and
in.
And I said, I'll go take him to the bar, get him drunk, and he'll be in the band by then.
I talked to you that night, and we were speaking to something of the sort. And I do remember you saying this, Dean, we're very lucky to have him. I don't know if you remember that conversation.
Well, I'll tell you this, because I'd already been friends with Ed for a long time at this point, too. And when I came to see y'all on the Dosage Tour in Nashville, I was like, holy crap. I was like, these two worlds have collided of things that I love. Obviously, love the band, and I've always loved Rab. And I was like, I get to see both of this thing happen at the same time. I was like, this is fucking awesome.
Yeah, but
So church, that's kind of a common thread. Ed told me that you kind of came up in the church. You did revivals and stuff, basically.
Oh, yeah.
Knocking on church doors and doing gigs. Tell me about this stuff.
Early on, my dad, I wanted to play music. I got into it, whatever. But I was that kid that, my dad was a praise and worship leader.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a kid that was like, hey, the bass player for the Sunday morning service can't make it. I need you to learn how to play bass. Okay, I learned to play bass. Because I was a drummer originally. So I played drums most of the time. And it was like, we need a bass player for Sunday. You need to learn to play bass. So I learned to play bass. We need a guitar player for Sunday. It's like, okay, I'll learn how to play guitar. And that was like, that was my, I credit a lot of that because like having that opportunity to just like, especially young when you're like learning like so easily and stuff like that. Like it was really important.
Wow.
And I, to me, like it was cool.
And your dad's a musician?
Yeah, he sings. My granddad's a songwriter. So it's kind of in the family.
I heard he's worked with Elvis Presley. Right?
My granddad was big in the gospel world, and one of his most famous songs, the Blackwood Brothers recorded on RCA, and then they like did a showcase and announced my granddad as the writer, and Elvis was on the showcase, and Elvis came up to my granddad afterwards and was like, "Hey man, we need to write songs together."
How cool is that?
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
The sweet breeze flow. I saw kindness gone. Hope still lingers on. Drink myself a newfound pity. Sitting alone in New York City, and I don't know why. Listening, the death of offering. Have we eyes to see? The mud is gathering. All the words that I've been reading have now started the act of leading. And you, woman. So I walked flying high, and I stepped to the edge, see my world below. And I laughed myself as the tears rolled down. It's such a one I know. It's what I know. Bring myself a newfound pity. Sitting alone in New York City, I don't know why. So I walk upon high, and I step to the edge, see my world below. And I laugh myself to the end.
So another thing, I got to ask you about this.
Yeah.
The Guinness Book of World Records thing. Just tell me how this all came about.
It was totally a friend of mine named Boo McAfee, and he invented a little digital or analog little machine that you hit a pad, the timer starts going down for 60 seconds, and each time you trigger a stroke, it reads how many there are. And so I was backstage getting ready to do something like drum day, and I got like 898, and he's like, who just did this? I'm like, I just did. I was warming up. He's like, there's no way you just got 898. Do it again. And then I got like 901. And he's like, you know what? Would you be willing to try to, like, we'll get a hold of Guinness. Let's try to, like, make this a, you know, almost like a promotional thing. And long story short, we did. And embarrassingly enough, there's a couple, it got some good press, but then it, like, went the other way because people thought it was rigged. So we then would go to those trade shows and they're like, Rab won again. No, there's no way it's rigged. You know, the pad's broken. People got like really mad. I was getting like a lot of hate mail.
Really?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Which was fantastic. And so, but the funniest
hate
thing
mail
is.
Hate from drumming, man.
Oh, maybe.
They just for being a fast drummer. Before the show and hear him warm up.
I was about to say, to all the haters, I've seen him do this, and it's like.
Annoying
like,
as hell.
You didn't do that.
He was joking with me one day. He's like, yeah. I was like, show me how you did the Guinness Book of World Records thing. He's like, you know, you just start. He's like, I'm like, whoa, dude. Holy crap.
And that happened. And the probably the funniest, weirdest, cool thing with that, there was a like this MTV show. And then there was a VH1 kind of rock and roll record breaker. So at that time in my life, it was a neat thing because I wasn't in a band. I wasn't doing anything. So it was nice to get a little hint of some of that coverage. And then weirdly enough, I think like in 12 locations, they did a. Those funny, like, here's the dude's biggest shoes or world's tallest man. And then in 12 of them, they have, the two dudes on the motorcycles eating hamburgers or whatever.
did you get to meet anybody else in the book? I mean, did you?
Like, no.
The guy with the horn growing out of his head, did you ever meet that dude?
The guy that smoked the most cigarettes of all time.
That guy's face is that big.
Oh, that is amazing. So I got to be in some of those exhibits at those Ripley's museums or whatever. So, but it was, I'm also glad that that's.
So someone else hold
like
the record
freak
right
show
now?
At a circus or something?
Yeah.
Did someone eclipse that record?
Yeah, and I'm very glad. In fact, Mike Mancini, now in Dream Theater, and I'm so not only am I happy he did it, but I can't catch what he did.
Really?
Yeah, no.
What's his number?
Something like 1,200.
No way.
I did like 1,070 something.
You need to practice more.
How did it go down when they were actually testing you? Like they just showed up. A guy to watch you, or did you send it in?
It's an
official Guinness guy there.
That day there was a woman named Alice Moss from Guinness, and she came to Florida and Orlando. We did it out front of the Guinness Experience thing, and they VH1 filmed it. And
I think you're the first Guinness Book, qualified guy that I've ever met.
He held the record.
How many years do you have it?
Like six, something like that. I really, it went so backwards for me that I kind of was like, nope, didn't do that. Because everyone's like, you can't play.
It was a backfire.
Big time. Like, you can't play. There's no way you can play music or a groove if you're doing that stuff.
That's insane.
So I shied away.
Who's laughing now, Rab?
Exactly. been a really cool ride, man. I've had some awesome artists come over here, and it's just kind of like, you know, just perpetuated this really cool energy that's come over here. And like, you know, I didn't get in, it's a passion play for me. It's not for the money for sure, but there's, I quickly find out there's all different types of currency, and I'm getting so much out of it just right here, what we're doing right now, man. It's so good because it's a different kind of gig, right? I don't know if you guys have ever done anything quite like this at someone's house. It's kind of strange, you know, a little bit.
Well, I've done it before, so it's
you
okay.
Have, that's me, right. So yeah, no, yeah. Yeah. What do you think about this, Will?
Yeah, man, you're an awesome host, first off. Well, your house and this place is great.
I appreciate it.
I love your sound stage. It's awesome. And I've seen the channel, and I've seen some of the performances, man. It's a really cool thing.
I appreciate it.
For me, it just feels authentic. It feels like you're going to get the real deal from the artist. And the way, just even this communication with how you're interviewing us, it's just, it's cool, man. Like, you're extracting, like, the good stuff. And, like, it's not surface level. You know you're... what you're doing.
Yeah, man. Well, I appreciate you saying that. It's not a premeditated thing, you know. I don't have notes or anything like that. I'm just kind of flying and just kind of going with it, and that's
pretty much what we just did down there too.
That's the beauty of it all, right? I think we're gonna wrap it with that, man. Collective Soul, thanks again for coming. It's fucking awesome. I know I mean nothing to you guys, but I might mean a little bit.
Honestly, I mean this with all my heart.
Yeah.
You did a fucking great job interviewing me.
Man, thank you, man. I appreciate that. That means a lot. It really does.
That was fun, and you orchestrated some good conversation.
That's cool. Well, thanks for saying.
Cheers. And the print shop crew.
The print shop crew, yeah.
Print shop crew.
Live at the print shop. Now check it out. Collective Soul.
Where are they gonna lead me to? I still have wishes that haven't come true. Well, I trust and I turn at what this life it can give. Yeah, I trust and I turn. Life I should live. Are you the answer to all I need? Are you the answer? The answer for me. Your patience is leaving my side. I'm gonna circle back to see what I can find. Let the sky rain down on me. All I should know. Let the sky rain down on me. Wisdom to grow. Are you the answer? The answer to all I need.
those days, my yesteryears, packed with pride, filled with fear. I was pushing forward lies that didn't make believe. Walked like the same ran with a band of thieves. I was looking up, why feeling down? Yeah, I searched in my directions for some universal smile. I was looking up, why feeling down? And then I heard your heartbeat, baby, and I saw your precious smile. Stars, I wish to part. Said God is brave, but you're on your own. Live a life of color, practicing in black and white. Comfort in my creed, just Jesus ain't by my side. I was looking up, oh, I'm feeling down. Some universal smile. I was looking up, while feeling down. And then I heard your heartbeat, baby, and I saw your precious smile.
Found out pretty quickly he likes to shop like Michael Jackson. Yeah. I'll take that. Two of those. You got that in blue. I'll take that one right there. And I was like, oh my God, I like this dude a lot. You know?